like coming here to Fleetwood and sitting down on this bench. It's a break, isn't it? There's always something to see. Distant ships, smoke on the horizon, little sailing yachts, motorboats. And nowadays you get these adventurous types, windsurfing. I like to swim in the sea. When I was younger, I'd come down here with me bag of stuff, trunks, towel, packet of sandwiches, flask of tea. Why does tea taste different from a flask? I've always wondered. What a palaver it was getting changed. Wrap the towel round you. Take your clothes off without letting the towel drop. Good grief. And then a book to read later on. Perhaps a magazine or the daily paper. I always got the Guardian. I like to read Neville Cardus writing about cricket from Old Trafford. Can't afford it, no. Last time I looked, it was £2.50 a copy. It always was a bit more expensive than the other papers, but £2.50 a day is £15 a week. And that's without getting the Observer on Sundays. Goodness knows what that costs. And £15 a week is £780 a year. I had to stop getting it every day. I still get one as a little treat for myself. You know, if there's been something interesting happen, like a disaster somewhere, or a sporting event, or political scandal. Mind you, I've got one every time there's a political scandal, I'll be back to buying it every day. There's not so many people now as there used to be. Once upon a time, this beach would be crammed. Everybody sat on their tea towels and deck chairs, children running in and out of the sea, building sandcastles where they could find space, planting little paper flags on the walls and the turrets, and then watching as the tide came in and washed their efforts away. Mary and me would come here when we were courting. That'd be us one day, we'd say. Then we'd go off to the cafe by the lighthouse, fish, chips and peas, 2 and 6, including tea, bread and butter, before we got the train for home, change at Preston. The plans we had. Mary had a job in Makinson's Arcade, in a shop that sold army surplus stuff, clothing and school uniforms. She liked it. She liked meeting people, liked talking to them. She'd get a Wigan Corporation bus in the morning, in time to get to work for a cup of tea before opening up at 9. Went there straight from school at 15. Finished one life on a Friday, started new one on Monday, she'd say. Never did any exams. What do I want them for? I'm happy with my job. No. She wasn't what you might call ambitious. It was handy, mind. She'd get me all kinds of things with her staff discount. You know, boots and shirts for work. And I bought a tent once, intending to go camping with her in the Lake District. But her mother wouldn't let her go. Not until you're married, she said. Right, I thought. If that's the case, we'll get married. First doctor I saw, long time ago now, late 1980s, said, probably nothing to worry about, just a bit of IBS, irritable bowel syndrome. I thought it was the result of a curry I'd had the week before. He still stuck his finger up my bum, told me I'd need a colonoscopy, then we can be sure. I love the we bit. I went to a consultant, about the same age as me, from New Zealand. He asked me a load of questions. Did I smoke? No. Had I ever smoked? No. How much alcohol did I drink? About 5 pints of beer a week. Are my parents alive? Well, they were. And then a whole list of diseases and ailments, all of which, I'm happy to say, I hadn't had. Then he stuck his finger on me bum. I said to him, you've got a weird job. I know, he said, that's what my wife thinks. The seagulls are getting braver. I was here this time last year and one swooped down and nicked a chip right off my lap. Off he went with it in his beak. Well, I hope you like vinegar. Because I like vinegar and salt and plenty of it. I never took to mayonnaise. I was 30 before I knew what mayonnaise was. We always had salad cream in our house. When we had salad, that is. Can't imagine it going on anything else. But nowadays, people put all kinds of things on their food. Tomato sauce on roast dinners. HB sauce goes on everything. Funny how things turn out. I was in the court the other week, and I counted the number of different nationalities that were represented. There were curries from India, China, Thailand, Japanese sushi, Italian pizzas, German sausages. I inquired, had they got any Lancashire hot pot? They hadn't. I asked Mary to marry me, sat on this bench. We'd come for a day. A little break, just a day, that's all. I'd been listening to the weather forecast and I knew it was going to be a nice day. So we put some things into a bag, bus to town, train, change at Preston. I'd bought a ring from a jeweller in Wigan, and he said, if I kept the receipt, I could always bring it back. And it was easy to adjust if it didn't quite fit. Well, we'd been on the pier, played on the slot machines, we'd lost, of course. But we'd had some fun. Then we went on the pleasure beach, had a ride on the Dodgers and the Waltzer and the Skyrocket. I got Mary to go on the ghost train. We both nearly jumped out of our skin when that skeleton appeared from nowhere. It was nearly time to go home. And we were just sat here, holding hands. I'd got the ring in my pocket. And I said, Mary, will you marry me? She had her head on my lap. And she said, yes. We were only 21. It was 1960. The week before the first colonoscopy, I got sent a pack of stuff. There's a book explaining what's going to happen on the day, and the risks involved, and a form to fill in if I want to be sedated, I do. And packets of stuff to mix up into a drink to have the day before, to clean you out. The drink is disgusting. I have to mix it with some orange squash, and the only way I can drink it is to slug it back in one go. First one, nothing happens for about 40 minutes. By the time I get to the fifth, I may as well just sit on the bog and pour it straight down. Next day, I get a taxi to the hospital, get kitted out with a gown and my backside sticking out. Then, I go into this little room, nurses fussing around, load of questions, pretty much the same as before. And I lie down on this bench on my left side. Sedation goes in, and I can feel something slimy being rubbed around my bum. Knees up, please. And the camera being inserted. They have to pump you full of air to everything expand that you can see what's going on. I feel as though I'm going to fart and blow the whole thing out. And I look up, and there's a computer monitor. And on the monitor is a sort of red tunnel. There you are, says the doctor. That's what you look like from the inside. Great. The pier's gone now. It burned down a few years ago. Well, it had become derelict. Nobody used it for years and it was unsafe. I saw it one morning on Luke North Breakfast News. From where the camera was positioned, I could see this bench. I hope that don't go up as well, I thought. It took three fire brigades to bring it under control and put it out. And then all that was left was a tangle of metal out at sea, where the men fishing used to go. A skeleton, a bit like the one that jumped out of Mary and me. We fixed up to have the wedding at St. Thomas the Martyr. And then a little do in the church hall afterwards, used to be the local cinema. I put her name down for a council house. Although at first we were going to be living with her mother. Her dad had been killed in the war, 8th Army with Monty in the desert. Neither Mary nor her mother had ever seen where her dad was buried. I told her, I'll take you there one day on a little break. Gran was going to do the baking. 3 tiers of fruitcake. Save the top tier for the christening, old Gran had said. I'd got me suit from British Home Stores in town. Where the wedding dress was coming from, I never knew. I shouldn't ask, I was told. It's unlucky. My friend Jeff was best man. Him and me had been mates since we was at school. Infants class. Miss Draper. She had a stuffed owl under a glass dome by her desk. Frightened the life out of me until I realised it wasn't alive. I've still got our class photograph at home. There we all are, laughing at something. I could recall most of the names. But I lost touch with the others. They all moved away. Some went to university. Some went with work. The school's gone now as well. They turned it into houses. When one of them was up for sale recently, I pretended I was interested in buying it, so I went to go and have a look inside. Polished wooden floors, central heating, very nice. And where Miss Draper's desk and the stuffed owl used to be, that's where the telly now stood. It built a new school up the hill. It's got its own playing fields with goalposts and everything. I went there once for a meeting. It was lovely. Ulcerative colitis. That was the diagnosis. IBD. Irritable bowel disease. Not IBS, irritable bowel syndrome. Colon and rectum get inflamed. Nobody knows why people get it. Possibly a failing of the autoimmune system, but they do. I have. So I begin the treatment. Not to cure it, you can't, but to control it. And the IBD team I get sent to at hospital are absolutely fantastic. No inhibitions. And before long, neither do I. My poo is discussed, described and analysed for the amount, the consistency and the frequency. And I soon become very familiar with the Bristol stool chart. We sent out the invitations. What a job that was. I was scared stiff of upsetting someone by not including them. But we could only have 50 people. Dad bought a barrel of beer from the pub. Joe, the landlord, was going to tap it for him in the morning. Caterers were arranged. They were going to do a buffet with, you know, just sandwiches and bits of cheese and pineapple on cocktail sticks and then vol-au-vents. Pudding was apple pie and cream. Joe had a license, so he was going to run a bar afterwards. Mum and Dad were going to put 20 quid into the kitty. It all sounded great. That's the hotel I had booked for the honeymoon, over there. I never told anyone where we were going. It was just bed and breakfast in those days. Shared bathroom down the corridor. Washing facilities in each room, but no ensuite or anything like that then. And you had to be in by 10:30, otherwise you run the risk of being locked out. Breakfast was cereal or tin grapefruit. Bacon and egg,
and then as much tea and toast as you wanted. Mary's uncle Arthur had a Rover. He was going to drive Mary to the church. He had some white ribbon he was going to tie on the bonnet. And then he was going to be the one to give her away. Well, it made sense because he was her dad's brother. I was just going to walk down to the church from our house. Then after the ceremony, Uncle Arthur would drive us up to the church hall for the do. I had a taxi book for taking us away afterwards. Jeff had his speech. "Nothing too rude, I hope," Mary's mother had said. Jeff just grinned. Goodness knows what he had lined up. I had my speech ready. Not much. Just thanking everyone for what they'd done for us. Dad said I had to say that the thanks were from my wife and I. He said, that always gets a laugh. I lived with the ulcerative colitis for years, but much of the time it was dormant. I even forgot I had anything wrong with me. Then, slowly, flare-ups came more often, and the drugs got more powerful, but their impact got less. And I was put on steroids and drugs with long, impressive-sounding names. Vedolizumab and infliximab. And then, one November, late November, it just went out of control. I was going to the toilet 20 times a day. The team told me I had to come into hospital through A&E. By midnight, I'd been poked and prodded, more fingers up my bum, and they kept me in for 12 days, almost up to Christmas. I hope she's been happy. It was a bit awkward at the time, but now, well, life's too short, isn't it? On the day, it didn't happen, that's all. No point in dwelling on it. You turn a corner and life goes on. The caterers were really good about everything. Mum made up little parcels of the food and gave it out to all the guests. Dad took the barrel of beer home and sucked it over the next month. I still have to pay the vicar and the organist, though. Last I heard, she was living in the Midlands. The bloke she married opened up his own clothing shop, and then another, and another, and so on. They'll have grandchildren and all, right? They got married about a year later. I came here on that day as well. I couldn't face it. I wonder if she ever got to go to Tobruk, where her dad was buried. "We may have to take your colon out," I was told. Again, that "we." "You'll have a stoma for the waste to come out and be fitted with a colostomy bag." I was scared shitless. Well, not literally, obviously. They gave me some leaflets to read. "There's one person in every 300 has this operation for one reason or another. There's even a rugby league team made up entirely of men who've got a stoma." I thought, well, if they can play rugby league with it, then anything's possible. Mary's mother sent me the ring back. She wrote me a lovely note saying she was sorry how things had turned out and hoped I wasn't too upset. Wrote it on proper note paper, Basildon Bond, not just something torn out of an exercise book. She always had a nice handwriting, used a fountain pen. It came with a card, and on the card was a picture of Fleetwood. There's an irony for you, I thought. I couldn't find that receipt, so I kept the ring. Left it in its box, put it in a drawer. I put the wedding ring in there as well. I thought that perhaps one day but it never happened. I don't think I could have faced that jeweller anyway. I only saw Mary once after that, at her mother's funeral. I'd gone out of respect and just sat at the back of the church. Then, when they was all leaving, she glanced to the side and she saw me. And she just said, "Sorry." Silently, of course, but I couldn't have read. She had her children with her. They were all teenagers by then, crying their eyes out. I didn't go to the wake afterwards. It would have been a bit awkward. So I just went home. They did try to bring my ulcerative colitis back under control with double doses of the drugs and more steroids. Steroids were dreadful. My face swelled up. I got the shakes, I had cramps, insomnia, but by March, it did seem to be working. I'd slowly come off the steroids. Trips to the loo were down to only about 3 or 4 a day. The thing now would be, could the drug hold on its own? But then, second week of April, like clicking a switch, I was back to where I'd been the previous November. So I called the team. When Jeff got married, I was his best man. I made everybody laugh when I told them about how him and me would see who could pee over the wall of the boys' toilets in the school playground. The things we got up to. I'm godfather to their son, Andrew. They only had one. I taught him to fish in the canals around where we live. He goes all over the place, though. Last summer, he went to France and caught a 90-pound catfish. He showed me the pictures. "Come on," he said, "I'll take you. It'll be a little break for you." Well, perhaps I will one day. Dad died 20 years ago, and Mum went 4 years later. So, the house is mine. They'd worked so hard to pay off that mortgage, but now it's me that has the benefit. Doesn't seem fair somehow. From me making that phone call to the operation was 4 weeks to the day. In between, I was transferred from the IBD team to the stoma team and I met the surgeon. I'll miss the IBD team. We'd become friends. I send them a card at Christmas too. The surgeon, he did a bit more poking and prodding, but no finger up the bum this time. The stoma team took me through everything that was going to happen on the day and how I would cope with things once I got home. When I went to see the consultant for her to sign me off, she said, "You've had enough, haven't you?" And I just burst into tears. The operation was 8 hours, keyhole. How did they do it? Did they just make a little hole and pull the colon out? But then, when I was coming round after the operation, recovering from the anaesthetic, I looked down. And there it was, this beige bag stuck to me. "So, this is it then," I thought. "How do I sleep on? Shower? Dress?" The first few days were really upsetting. I'm all right though. In my 30s, I trained to be a primary school teacher. One colonoscopy I had, the assistant nurse was a former pupil. That tested my lack of inhibition, I can tell you. I retired at 61. I'd had to stop playing cricket a few years before that, but I'd played for 40 seasons. And now I score for the second 11. They're really good to me. They pick me up for away games and then bring me home afterwards. I still go fishing, and I play bowls. Crown green, of course, all that flat stuff they have down south. I never could understand the attraction of just going up and down the same alleyway. But in the winter, I play crib for the White Lion. We came third in the league last year. And there's always going, watching Wigan Rugby or Wigan Athletic with Jeff. In 5 years now, since my operation, I got used to the bag. I change it every other day and I empty it about 3 times a day. I've had a couple of leaks, but nothing too serious. But once I got faith in it to sleep on it and shower, I was fine. And I can eat as many jelly babies and marshmallows as I want. I went to see the surgeon not long after the operation. And he said to me, "Well, Alan, you and your colon, you weren't friends, were you?" They'd sent it away and done some tests and found there was nothing more sinister going on. And the Stoma team now are every bit as supportive as the IBD team were. Since Mum died, Jeff and Irene always invite me home on Christmas Day. I take them a tin of Quality Street and make a contribution to the cost. Irene says I shouldn't, but it gets expensive and they're on a budget like me. And I built a model railway in the spare bedroom. Nobody's ever seen it, it's only for my own entertainment, but it passes the time in the dark nights. "Give your Stoma a name," I was told. I thought, I'll call it Sainsbury, because they give you a bag for life. Be my 80th birthday soon. Jeff and Irene say they've got something planned for me. So you see, really, I'm quite busy. And every year, on what would have been our anniversary, I come here for a little break. Experienced. So thank you very much. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.